who has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and made a place for us in the kingdom of his beloved Son, we welcome you, grace to you, and peace. As we meet to celebrate anew the coming of God's kingdom, we hear revealed the mystery of God's loving purpose for us, how that when we were far off, he met us in his Son and brought us home, how he humbled himself to take our human nature, that we might share his divine glory. Let us then so celebrate this coming with our carols and hymns of praise, that our lives may be charged with his life, that we may bear witness to his glory, and so bring light to those who sit in darkness. So first we pray for those among whom the Christ was born, the poor and helpless, the aged and young children, the cold, the hungry and the homeless, the victims of poverty, injustice and oppression, the sick and those who mourn, the lonely and the unloved, those in despair or in the shadow of death. Then, as we hear again the message of peace on earth and goodwill among all his people, we pray for the leaders of the nations, that all may be inspired to work together for the establishment of justice, freedom, and peace the world over, and that we may bear true witness to this hope in a divided world, we pray for the peace and unity of Christ's body, the Church Universal, that the whole earth may live to praise his name. Finally, as we rejoice with the saints in heaven and on earth, we remember all who have gone before us with the sign of faith, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we offer up our prayers for the coming of his kingdom, in the words he himself has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. May the Lord, when he comes, find us watching and waiting, now and at all times. Amen. Our first hymn, Hark, a Herald Voice is Calling, is number 5 in the Green Book.
Thank you. heavens and the earth. And the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. And a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. And God said, Let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Here endeth the reading.
Thank you.
rise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. Here ends the reading.
He will come like frost one morning when the shrinking earth opens on mist to find itself arrested in the net of alien sword-set beauty. He will come like dark one evening when the bursting red December sun draws up the sheet and penny masks its eye to yield the star-snowed fields of sky. He will come like crying in the night, like blood, like breaking, as the earth writhes to toss him free. He will come like a child.
Oh, and he said to where Denise left him. We know the scene. The room variously furnished, almost always electric, a book, always the tall lily. Arrived in solemn parandum of great wings, the angelic ambassador standing among them, whom she acknowledges, a guest. But we are told of meek obedience. No one mentions courage. The engendering spirit did not enter without her consent. God waited. She was free to accept or to refuse, to us integral to humanness. Aren't there annunciations of one sort or another in most lives? Some unwillingly undertake great destinies, enacting the sullen pride, uncomprehending. More often those moments when roads of light and storm open from darkness in a man or woman are turned away from in dread and away from weakness in despair and relief. Ordinary lives continue. God does not smite them, but the gates close, the pathway vanishes. She had been a child who played, ate, slept like any other child, but unlike others, wept only for pity, loved in joy, not triumph. Compassion and intelligence fused in her, indivisible. Called to a destiny more momentous than any in all of time, she did not quail, only asked a simple, how can this be? And gravely, courteously, took to heart the angel's reply, perceiving instantly the astounding ministry she was offered, to bear in her room infinite weight and lightness, to carry in hidden finite limitless 9 months of eternity, to contain in slender vase of being the sun of power, in narrow flesh the sun of light, then bring to birth, push out into air, a man child needing like any other milk and love, but who was God.
Come, O Lord, and visit us in peace.
Come to your people when we wait for the dawn of your salvation.
With you, O Lord, is the well of life.
And in your light shall we see light.
We shall see, and our hearts shall rejoice.
God shall comfort his waiting people.
Almighty God, the one for whom we watch and wait, as your kingdom dawns, turn us from the darkness of sin to the light of holiness, that we may be ready to meet you in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. May Christ, when he comes, find his people watching and waiting. Amen.
Come, O Lord Jesus.
O come, O come, Emmanuel. the Gospel of John. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Here ends the reading.
Before I begin the address, I would like to make a note of thanks to the choir. All the scholars and I've heard the music for all the work that we've seen before this evening. It's been terrific. We should remember that the term began, or just before the term began, with the choir singing the world premiere of an anthem by Mr. James McMillan for the millennium of St. Ben's Church. And it's ended with what is perhaps the world premiere of a piece by our own Colin Millington. And I don't think we will have heard any premiere to beat that in any of the colleges of Cambridge this evening. So thank you very much to all of you, and especially to Colin for that piece of music. From the second poem this evening, we know the scene, the room variously furnished, almost always a lectern, a book, always a tall lily. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Christian faith is all about the story of Jesus. If you were going to tell that story, where would you start? Perhaps like this. Once upon a time, in Bethlehem, the city of David, was born a baby whose name was Jesus. That's an obvious place to begin, but it arrives on the scene too late. We should track 9 months back and say, once upon a time, in the little town of Nazareth, a Jewish girl received the visit of an angel. That's a better start, the girl and the angel. If we were making a film, it would provide an arresting opening sequence. Let us picture the scene. Let us, for a moment, be arty cinema directors. Before the opening titles, we hear music that could come from the Middle East. The camera pans around a room. It's the room of a poor family. In the room is a young girl. She is younger than any of you, and she's occupied with some task or other. Then there is light, the rustle of wings, and a look on her face that is not quite familiarity and not quite surprise. To set the scene for the story of Jesus, we can begin there. Once upon a time, a long time ago, in a foreign land, in a town called Nazareth, there was a girl named Mary. And of course, Mary had a mother, and she had a mother, and she had a mother, right back to the beginning. Indeed, in that way, Mary sums up all that's gone before. She stands in at that moment for the whole human race. In our mental cinema scene, there's an angel who is God's representative, and there is Mary who is ours. As a Greek prayer puts it, you, Mary, have made answer for all creation to the redeeming will of God. For Christians, Mary represents the people of Israel in that meeting with all their religious hopes and dreams. And indeed, she represents every woman, every person, because it was to make every person a child of God that God became a human person. that he could redeem human flesh, God took human flesh. And our college is, after all, dedicated specifically to that very divine human flesh. And he took it from Mary. Mary is that human being, again to whom our college is dedicated, chosen by God to represent us all in that great exchange. The exchange by which we gave God humanity and God gave us divinity. The day when God accepted human life as a gift from the human race. Although, of course, we have that life, we have that humanity, first of all, as a gift from our Creator. And in that extraordinary transaction, Mary stands for all of us. And you know how it goes from there, the birth of Bethlehem, the flight into exile in Egypt, Jesus baptized and traveling about teaching, Jesus who heals the sick, befriends the unbefriendable, Jesus who goes to Jerusalem and is arrested, tried and executed. The disciples, and Mary's among them, despair. But in the middle of that despair, Jesus rises from the dead. He ascends into heaven, the Holy Spirit comes, Mary is there too. And the apostles journey to the four winds, preaching the good news. We call Advent the first day of the church's new year because it begins the story of all of that. The cycle of the Christian year begins again today. Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Lent, Passiontide, Easter, Ascension, Pentecost, Trinity Sunday, Corpus Christi. But the new year might or could also be in our minds in a different way this evening, given that our cover image and Denise Levertov's poem, and my sermon for that matter, concern the Annunciation of the Angel Gabriel to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Because time was when the new year out there in the world began not on the 1st of January, but on the 25th of March, the Feast of the Annunciation. That's because we begin more this evening than just a new cycle of liturgical observance, important though that is. We begin the story of the beginning of the new world. And that starts with Gabriel and Mary. We heard earlier on the story of the creation of the world from Genesis, while the Annunciation begins the story of the recreation of the world. When God took flesh, yes, to restore us, but also for far more than that, to make us God's own family. As an aside, I think, by the way, that the Annunciation New Year is what gives us the rather odd date of the 6th of April for the new tax year in the United Kingdom. That's just the 25th of March shifted from the Julian calendar to the Gregorian one. So year by year, perhaps, that rather mundane worldly fact about tax years, tax of all things, can remind us of the medieval insight of starting the year with the Annunciation, just as we are this year beginning Advent and the new liturgical year with the Annunciation. Because that is the beginning of the story of the recreation of all things, which we can hail with rather wonderful words from one of the choir's anthems. Whence sky and stars and seas abyss, the earth and all that therein is, shall still with Lord and carol meet, the author of thine advent greet. Amen.
Thank you.
night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and put on the armour of light. Come, O Lord, comfort the soul of your servant.
Even so, O Lord, come.
O Lord Jesus Christ, come.
At evening time, look with us.
And in the morning, with your glory,
to guide our feet into the way of peace.
He who receives our prayers says, surely I come quickly. I am the root and offspring of David. I am the bright and morning star.
Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.
Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you. Scatter the darkness from before your path, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you, and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.